music. We want to hear more music. Good afternoon, everyone. Isn't this wonderful to be sharing a meal with your colleagues? I mean, we have really, really missed this, and it's so good to see familiar faces in the audience and new faces in the audience, and we're so glad to be able to do this signature event in person finally after a couple of years of not normal, right? So I am Melissa Bell. I'm the Vice President of Academic Affairs and Student Success at the Council on Post-Secondary Education. And before we jump into our lunch session, I do want to take 1 second to say thank you so much to the staff at the Louisville Marriott East. They do a great job every year. Yeah, thank you, because this conference would not go as smoothly if we didn't get our food and didn't get it on time. So now to our luncheon speaker. It's my honor and privilege to introduce to you today Dr. Nancy Zimpher. She's currently working at the National Association of System Heads, NASH, on a big new project. She's going to tell you all about it. But before coming to NASH, she had a distinguished career in higher education at several institutions, including a presidency at the University of Cincinnati up the road and a chancellorship at the SUNY system. She's also served on numerous boards and commissions and even co-founded Strive Together that focuses on the education pipeline. In each one of her roles, she has been known as an innovative thinker and a collaborator. So who is better to talk about innovation through collaboration than Dr. Zimpher? So everyone, please welcome Dr. Nancy Zimpher.
Took the long route so that you got more of the music, and my little stiletto just went through the crack in the platform. You know what I just said? My heel went in the crack of the platform, and I survived. I did not fall over. I know. I am thrilled to be here. I too want to thank the Marriott team. I think everybody got their food, and it's wonderful. So that's a terrific thank you to them. I really want to say to Aaron Thompson and to Joe Cusio, I could just say, did you listen to what they had to say? And then I could go home, because we are all pretty much on the same page. So Joe said that I should introduce myself, and I'll do that very quickly. The National Association of System Heads is part of that beltway cabal of trade associations that all together represent the Higher Education Secretariat. They advocate for us, they lobby for us, they monitor federal legislation, they pull together on crisis management for national agendas, but the smallest and most humble of these organizations is probably this National Association of System Heads. But what makes it remarkable is that it is national. It does include every state that has some form of a system or a council. And Aaron has the honor of being both a member of the State Higher Education Executive Officers, which we call SHEO, and also, happily, a member of the National Association of System Heads. You have your bases covered, Aaron. And we are so thrilled to have his leadership and the leadership of Kentucky. So that gives you a little bit of bearing, but I thought I would say a little bit about my upbringing. I have learned through my own roots to appreciate Appalachian communities. I was born and raised in a small Appalachian community. There are 32 counties in Ohio that are federally designated as Appalachian, but you top that. You have 52 counties, I think the number is, designated as Appalachian counties. And I particularly, as you'll see a little later on, resonate with the work around Berea, which is actually leading some of the most significant work in rural Kentucky. And my mother was a graduate of what was called then Western Kentucky Teachers College. I hope Western Kentucky State University that you are proud of your roots. But Melissa and Lily and all of your team who've done such a fabulous job putting this conference together, there was one element of my curriculum vitae that I'm sure you just overlooked. Because at age 18, as a senior in high school in this small rural community, I was nominated by our teachers in the high school to compete for the Junior County Fair Queen. And in those days, you really didn't have to exhibit any talent. You certainly didn't have to exhibit in what we would have called a bathing suit. What you had to do was talk. And so my friend at the high school and all the other women who were nominated for this role talked to the judges, and that was sort of the beginning and the end of it, and after all, they only had a half an hour for this. So this is not psychometrically sound, but I did win the Miss Gallia County contest in 1964, which I know, which actually is the honor of pinning ribbons on livestock. If you've never been, let's say, to a county junior fair. And riding home that night with my family, you know, exhibiting great pride that I had learned how to talk to judges, my mother reported that the woman right behind her said, you know, the ugliest one always gets it. I'm just thinking, that's my introduction. It's great practice and humility for being a university president or chancellor or a council president. So I need to get on with business here. I was invited here to talk to you about the word systemness and to try to unpack this terminology, to actually think about a framework for what it means to be system-centric or systemness, and to see if you could help me, help us elaborate on this concept, because we're thinking, as time goes on, the council and this wonderful configuration of individual institutions and entities will need to work even harder at working together. So that's my theme, that's my task, and I've got three illustrations of what we might mean by systemness, but I'm going to start in an unsuspecting quarter. This is Stephen Colbert. I don't know if this really looks like him or not. And I forgot to say, in my work, particularly at the State University of New York, I always had a lot of students working around me. Typically, they were students who had been the president of the student body at an individual campus and had represented themselves well as quite spokespersons and really interested in higher education and getting behind the veil. So my defense for some of these slides that are coming up is that they told me this would work. So this is the first of they told me this would work. This is Stephen Colbert inventing the word truthiness. That is the end of my knowledge of why this slide is up here. I don't know what he did with truthiness. They forgot to tell me that. But on the day when I was giving, I think, my third State of the University address, or State of the System address, we were talking about things I've already heard of today, better together, that we have to work together to get impact. We have to be together. We invented the word systemness. Now, this was, in every sense of the word, this was a joke. We were just having fun. I was just trying to be young and cool and, you know, with it. And I go, okay, I'll put it in the speech. Well, somebody in the audience immediately put it on Wikipedia. I go, wait a minute, this is our word, you know, pride, being number one. You know, Aaron, I want to be in charge of this word. So we not only grabbed it from his effort to put it on Wikipedia, we wrote a definition. Coordination of multiple components then, when working together, create a network of activity that is more powerful than any action of individual parts on their own. I could stop now, but I have to prove this point, I think. I have to work with you on how we can, and it's still a little bit of a joke. It's still a word, a bit tongue-in-cheek. It's 10 years old. I mean, the concept's been around. It's in the free openness of all of our sharing. I mean, just because something's on Wikipedia doesn't mean somebody can't claim ownership. And somebody could take us down. They could argue with systemness, and then we'd go away. But the point is that systemness is just a concept that helps us think about how and in what ways we work together, and what are the benefits from that. So I'm going to start with what I know from my former experiences serving as a president or a chancellor in three different higher education entities. And at this point, I'm really talking about strategic planning, although, yes, that is skyline chilly. But the only reason I'm using, remember, the people that do these slides, they're 20 years old. So I always have to translate a little bit. Okay, I'll try this. But the reason we use it is because it's five-way chili, which has something to do with spaghetti and sauce and onions and beans and cheese. And it's got a sweet taste to it. I don't know what you think about, you know, but I'm not for that sweet chili. But at any rate, it reminds me to say to you that throughout my career as a campus and then a system president or chancellor or whatever name you want to use, this has held me in pretty good stead. And I have to clock myself. So the first is vision, and I heard that. I heard Aaron say that. I heard you say that, Joe. Vision. By the way, I kind of like Jim Collins, and I kind of like the big, hairy, audacious goal, and I know it's a little bit dated, and I won't mention the state, but there's a state that passed a bill to exclude the word big, hairy, audacious goal. There's something offensive about it. I don't know whether that's the word hairy. I don't know. What is the, anyway, it's gone now in that state, and I'm not going to tell you who that is. But the vision thing is really important. And there's a colleague here at Moorhead who was in Milwaukee, and before Kevin Riley walked out, he could vouch for this. The most fabulous experience I had personally as setting vision at a university was in Wisconsin. And you know why? When the University of Wisconsin was founded 160 plus years ago, the wisdom of the legislature and the then governor said, we want to be that university that really serves the state. And we're going to call this the Wisconsin idea, that the boundaries of the university are the boundaries of the state. Now, of course, they would say now they are grossly international. What boundaries of the state? But you know, 160 years ago, that meant something. So there I am sitting at the University of Wisconsin, Milwaukee, pretty far away from Madison, pretty far away from the state capital. And I go, well, what is this Wisconsin idea? I knew nothing. They didn't even use it to recruit a chancellor to Milwaukee. But it didn't take us long, and not just me alone, it didn't take us long to figure out that our byline might as well be the Milwaukee idea. University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee, that the boundaries of our university are going to be the boundaries of the community. And it had been a long time since that institution had looked outside itself to talk about the community. And to this day, while it's probably not plastered all over the place like it was when I was there, people remember that there was some connection between that big historic idea of the Wisconsin idea, that the boundaries of the university are the boundaries of your community, your state, your national and international presence. I didn't have as much luck at Cincinnati. We ended up calling ourselves UC21, defining the new urban research university. It was too many words. I don't think it ever caught on. Nobody ever really blamed me for it. But what a reporter, when I arrived in Cincinnati 5 years after my Milwaukee experience, he said, "So, you know, with that swagger that only a reporter can attempt, I suppose we're going to be called the Cincinnati idea." Like as if you can take vision and make a cookie cutter out of it. No way. I wish, because it would have been easy and it was already in my lexicon and in my head, but instead we rose to another idea. And then when I got to SUNY, this is the State University of New York. There are 64 campuses in this university system, and we needed a vision. So we ultimately settled on the power of SUNY, but I really want to tell you how we got there, because in all cases, in all three cases, that vision was not mine. I, as chancellor, president, viscount, king and queen, do not carry a suitcase around with a vision. It has to come at the hands of many. And there was a day, not too long ago, when I could actually name these people. I am so past that. I can't even remember anybody's first name, let alone their last name. But what happened to me as an early president that was sort of confirmed two and three times is that you can't do it if it is not at the hands of many. And so I got in this sort of syndrome of naming a group of something, a couple of hundred, you know, had to be significant enough. We even had a group of 200 at SUNY, which is 500,000 students, 90,000 staff, 33,000 of which are university professors and faculty members. I mean, it's hard to think that you can achieve vision at the hands of many, but creating a process is a big part of it. Have you ever heard process is the new program? You don't get the process right, you are not going to get the program right. And it really, really stuck with me. And through this process of just bringing people together, we got to action. Now, this is a map of New York. And those are the 64 campuses. And when I arrived at SUNY on June 1, I met with the governor, because that was really what you did, right, Aaron? And the next day, I set out on a 64 campus tour, and I came home after Labor Day, literally. So you would think that when I got to Buffalo, I could see Buffalo, I could see Buff State, I could see Erie Community College, I could go to Niagara Community College, I could go to Jamestown Community College. Uh-uh. They wanted me on a certain day, in a certain way. And so I would often go from like Buffalo to Suffolk County, Long Island. That's why it took 3 months. And I never went into my office. I was never so sure that being in an office didn't really matter. What really mattered is talking to people, because we had to form this vision and this action at the hands of many. And so we did. I'm a big fan, again, of words like big, go big or go home, big ideas, big, hairy, big, big, big. And you know what? SUNY's pretty big. It kind of fit. But I grew up at Ohio State, and big was always, you know, we have to be more than big, but big does matter. So having the entirety of the state of Kentucky, that's big. That's, it gives you such leverage to do the good. So these were big ideas that became the strategic framework. And of course, out of that, we did try to lay the groundwork for a data system, which all I had to do was come to Kentucky. I could have learned about this way earlier, could have learned about it the easy way. I could have just modeled our work after your work. But nonetheless, that's a, remember, I'm building a theory of systemness, and I'm building it off of what I learned about strategic planning. Those were the metrics, the measures. And I also learned about telling the story, which often requires a deep respect for branding, which is not just a logo, but it's the name of what you do. It's the Student Success Collaborative. It's any vision that you lay in front of the larger audience. And I know this is what, bluegrass blue? What do you call your blue? You have a name for it? Well, SUNY was blue. So I called it SUNY Blue. And if I went into a store and I saw blue, I go, "Oh, you're selling SUNY Blue." And they would look at me like, "What are you talking about?" But I'm just really trying to summarize that I think vision is critically important. I think it's very important that it be built at the hands of as many in the entity as you can get represented. You know, to do big group work with, let's say, a place as big as the State University of New York, representative democracy has to work. Do not shy away from the fact that you can't reach everybody, but you can represent them. And another little lesson I learned about representation is best to let the organization send you their best. Because when we would pluck faculty to sit at tables outside of asking the faculty council, we were sort of accused of getting our favorite faculty, the ones who already like us, to sit at the table when the real challenge was to get the commitment out of those who aren't so sure about us, and that is called representative democracy. Okay, I've given you one flavor for developing a theory of systemness using my own personal experience in strategic planning, okay? Now I'm gonna move to pillars because I think I used process. Now I'm gonna use pillars to define a coming of age, in my own mind, learning about collective impact the hard way through experiment. So this is now a fast forward from Milwaukee or Cincinnati as an institution or SUNY. This is the city of Cincinnati, and more importantly, Cincinnati and Northern Kentucky. And 15 years ago, this was the profile. Of course, think of it now, high school graduation rates have increased. What, are we hovering around 85% graduating from high school? That's a universal number that's not broken down or disaggregated. But in Cincinnati, as a relatively new university president, wondering where are all the students from the Cincinnati public schools? They don't seem to be going to the University of Cincinnati. What's the matter with that picture? We realized statistically, Aaron, I'll just throw that word in because I'm not a statistician, 1 in 5 of those 100 ninth graders over time actually graduated with a college degree 4 to 6 years later. 1 in 5. And of course, we started disaggregating data at that time, and I won't even go into how many gaps there were in underrepresented populations, but this became our driver. This became our problem, our challenge, our, I would say, opportunity. And when you have a problem, I know Joe used cartoons. This is my absolute favorite, and since you'll have the slides afterwards, use it at will. It comes from the Albuquerque Gazette or whatever their Tribune is, but it is just priceless. When we have a problem, the first thing we try to do is figure out who the culprit is, and it is anybody but me. So that was us in Cincinnati, and I want to say Cincinnati and Northern Kentucky. And I also want to say that the people who got the bright idea that we weren't doing very well getting kids into college, 2 or 4 year college, not only from Cincinnati, not only from the public schools, but the diocesan schools, but also Newport and Covington. We were not doing well. So 3 presidents got together and began to talk about how we could fix college access. Well, of course, we couldn't do that without the superintendents, and then later we couldn't do that without the United Way and the Boys and Girls Club and all of the social agencies that speak to wraparound organizations. But the claim is that on this napkin, we made history. Now, I don't think this is the original napkin, but it is a manifestation. And every day now when I'm in a bar or a pub or, you know, I look at what people are jotting down on that napkin because there might be some really historically important thing there. At any rate, it turned out to this. Why? Because we put a few graduate students on the napkin project and said, look up all the research on where are the pivotal stations for making a difference in that pathway that is at the core of your ideas. All four of those pathways. Where is the critical problem? We sort of naive university presidents who started this conversation thought it was just high school to college. Au contraire. You know this. Aaron mentioned this 1,000 times. It's this. But who's going to read that? Besides the graduate students who are writing theses on it. Nope, it's this. I mean, Joe, this is pretty graphic. This is translating a deep and researchable concept into these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's still 6. It used to be 6, and there was no career. Then we added career, and somehow they bundled 2 or 3 things together. But you know what? We got all the way back to birth. Not when life begins, trust me, we're not in that discussion, but we are working now, 15 years later, very directly with pediatric practitioners because they do a lot of the diagnostic work. They're the ones that tell the parents where your child is on some developmental theory. And they're the ones that tell the preschool educators what it means and what kids need at that time. And of course, at this time, 15 years ago, 50% of the students coming to kindergarten were not ready for kindergarten. So this became a national effort, which harmlessly is called cradle to career. That word, that term has stuck, although there's been a lot of debate about cradle. There's even more debate about career still today. But the pipeline word has stuck. And the reason I know all this is because it's still being written about and talked about. And President, I'll call you by your first name, Ashir, because I didn't practice your last name. Ashir, up there is Jim Votruba. You see him up there? And then there are 2 superintendents from Newport and Cincinnati, and then there's the head of Cincinnati State, and somewhere in there is the head of Gateway. I'm just telling you, this was a real partnership of real people working together every day to get kids from birth to career or cradle to career as we know it today. And it is alive today, and it is documented in an article, I think, could be on the reading list. We could put it in the impact exchange. This is the Stanford Social Innovation Review. And if you want to read more about what it means to be systemic and system thinking and systemness, you can do no better than this journal because it takes the veil off various partnerships around the country. And in this article in 2011, they talked about Cincinnati and this thing we call Strive Together. They talked about cleaning up a lake in Virginia. They talked about bringing down obesity, ending homelessness. They gave great examples. And this was the day when the term, you know, academics, you think of something and you create some terminology around it. And usually it has your name on it. Is this the way it works, Joe? I don't know. They called it collective impact. Again, that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts, that together we can, that better together. And the source document for this concept of learning how to work together is in that edition of the Stanford Social Innovation Review. And that's also where the word backbone came from. That, you know, wouldn't you call the collaborative a backbone? I'd like to think that the council is a backbone. It is a backbone for all of higher education in this country. But I wanted to introduce this example of systemness by saying that while this example is near and dear to me, I still believe that higher education's relationship to the K-12 sector is still parallel play. You see kids in the playground, parallel play. I'm not sure we have our heart in it yet. And as a teacher educator, I spent countless hours from the podium at SUNY saying, we prepare the teachers who teach the kids who come to college ready or not. This is our supply chain. This is our connection to the K-12 sector. And so this concept of collective impact that you have the convening power. Now that's new. I didn't say that necessarily about strategic planning, but I came to really appreciate what it means to be a convener. And Aaron said it best, at every level. Maybe you said it, Josie, I got you too confused now. One of them said, you can be a convener at every level of the organization. Now think about that. It's the convening power that gets big ideas on the table and then allows you to identify those strategic goals and teaches us how to create the kind of baseline data that is evidence-based for all the decisions that we are making. And then most importantly, teaches us how to sustain success. And I will tell you, this was my first introduction to improvement science. And I'm so thrilled to hear that this is a tool, a methodology that is spreading like wildfire across the state of Kentucky. This is where we did tutorials, first with the Carnegie Foundation for the Advancement of Teaching, and then from the Annie E. Casey Foundation, and then there are now these days tons of consultants who are coaching us in strategic improvement. And in Cincinnati, you know who the coach was? The Cincinnati Children's Hospital. Because you know who has figured out collective impact? You said it, Joe. Let's see, if you're exclusive about going to the hospital, it's because you're not sick in the first place. But what we are learning from healthcare, and for those of you who are in allied health professions, is that improvement is critical to the quality of care. And when you think about a patient and you think about a student, they both need high quality care and they need a methodology. So I'm going to say a little bit more about that in my third example. I'm close, Melissa. Are we doing okay? I came here to deliver this message and by golly, I'm going to, okay? So, the imperatives. Okay, we were at process of strategic planning and then we were, I can't even remember now, something about collective impact and now we're at imperatives. I'm just making up words here, but I had three illustrations and this is my third. So, let's fast forward to COVID. I left SUNY on January 1, 2020, and I retired for 30 days. 30 days. Because I could see this, whatever they were talking about in December and January, this was really becoming a thing. And we weren't going to do so well if we didn't make some major adjustments. And so lo and behold, this is our finest hour. In 2 weeks, post-secondary education went remote. I mean, we have never done anything that fast in our lives. And you lived through it. You did it. But then, I mean, as if that wasn't enough, they started talking about this is the moment for transformation. Now, I think maybe Aristotle said this, but everybody says, I like to say, don't let a crisis go to waste. And I go, do you know how many other people have said that? You did not invent that, but the point stuck. Everybody is calling for a transformative agenda. What did we learn in that pandemic that we did not heretofore know? Well, I'll tell you what, one thing we learned is that systems are not the bad egg we thought they were. We thought they were regulatory, we thought they were accreditors, at Cal State they have this thing called the executive order. They tend to issue them on Fridays. And do you remember this, Joe, in your time at Cal State? And you go, take that executive order language out of there because it makes you look like you're a regulator when really what you are is a support system, an enabling system. So, this notion of transformation helped systems step into a position where they were seen as more helpful. Why? Who made the policies about remote? Who decided and leveraged what the governor was telling you to do, or the legislature, or the parents, or the students? Somebody had to make all those decisions, and you benefited from that. Don't tell me you didn't. Because we weren't going to make that decision, 40 institutions individually by themselves. You know this. And it was, well, I'll use the word cover. It was a little bit of cover. It showed you that if we could make some decisions together, it would free the rest of us to do what we do best and leave some of the politics of life to the guy that wears, you know, the big job. That's a pretty good thing. He wants to do it. You can see that. He enjoys doing it. And you benefit from that. It really matters. So just as soon as we went remote, we started thinking these systems about what we should do that would be transformative. And since no idea is really original, I remember looking on the web and somebody was talking about the big rethink. I go, that's what we're gonna do. And it came to be that as I was volunteering to help the National Association of System Heads get through this horrible, challenging crisis called COVID, we launched the big rethink. And I was comparing notes with Lily about the formation of the collaborative, of the Student Success Collaborative. We spent 18 months, remember, process is the new program, at the hands of many. You don't have the convening power, you don't have collective buy-in. So, oh, surprise, surprise, we formed a group of 100. How original is that? Who did that ever before? Okay, we just learned that representation of these 65 systems across the country was probably a way that we could see ourselves through, quote, transformation, and sooner or later get on the other side of it to articulate where systems are going in the future. And so through lots of processes, process is the new program, we issued a survey two or three times. We did a Delphi survey in the end, trying to calibrate opinion. We had webinars. We had seminars. We had anything that you could get people together during the COVID time to figure out what was going to be our transformation agenda. It's just like exactly what you do on your campus, what you do in your systems, and this conversation was across the nation, actually. There are officially 65 systems in this country. Only 6 states don't have a system. Most have some kind of convening council or the institutional system I learned more about at the State University of New York and also, for that matter, the University of Wisconsin. So process, 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 closure, getting ideas, checking them out, testing them out. We formed design teams. Why? We read that on the online as well. This is a good way to make decisions. We made up a lot of the process, but we had one. And now we kind of brag about having had one. Usually there's some music with this. See, I'm telling you, these young people that surrounded me at SUNY are still working with us, and they're still incredibly creative, and hopefully this is done. But after 18 months, with a kind of representative discussion, we decided to call ourselves the Power of Systems. We had to leave that lovely big rethink behind and say, we're adults now, we've spent 18 months doing this, we gotta call ourselves something. And we need a subtitle. Whatever big idea doesn't have a colon and a subtitle, right? You gotta have that. So we really, really stewed over advancing prosperity for the nation, but advancing is an action, a forward moving. We chose prosperity because of all the work on social mobility. We know now it's not the degree. The degree and credentials of value are one of our measures in your pathways, but really moving people into the middle class and beyond is a testimony to social mobility. And so for the nation, we're the nation's systems. Of course we're gonna declare this for the nations. And you know, it's been 12 years since President Obama launched the modern day version of the moonshot. This was first in the world, and you know, Lumina got in there too, and what, 60% by 2025 is getting close, it's getting scary, are we gonna make it? No, we're not gonna make it. We're at 51%. We're not gonna make it. So we're going to have to reset our goals. We're going to have to recalibrate. But that's why the language of prosperity for the nation meant so much to us. So again, I was talking to Lily because I've never stood up an organization. I've always been hired by an organization that already exists. But Lily, good girl, she gets hired to stand up something that doesn't exist, like this Student Success Collaborative. So we have advanced from our launch in December to three ideas. We're creating an Institute for Innovation and Improvement for systems. We're creating a state system center to monitor state policy and hopefully move it in the right direction. And we do need a better federal partner. I want to tell you, had Build Back Better gotten more traction, the word system would not have been in it. We wouldn't have gotten a dime for the council because system was not in that version of the legislation, which, trust me, it is now. Even if the bill doesn't pass, it's sort of a Pyrrhic victory. At least we've got people thinking about us. And again, we have these goals. And here's the thing, Aaron. We want to set a goal for 2030, like you are doing here. We have a metric task force for these systems debating what the measures of credential completion, credential and degree, social mobility, and then our role in bringing down the cost of college. And that metric committee, which is chaired by Tristan Dinley, who's probably pretty well known across the country for his work in Tennessee and Georgia in data analytics. And by December of this year, we are going to announce the metrics we are chasing as a system of systems. And Aaron, if I were betting, I think it's going to be 70%. Because I know it's a stretch, but we've been dilly-dallying around, and we're still at 51%. Now, that may not hold, and I think you'll have a lot to say about that, but it pushes on 60. It makes us stop and say, if it's 60, we've still got a lot of people not in the game. So whether or not we're able to pull that off, I honestly do not know. But we have been driven by a set of imperatives that will match anything you're talking about. We think that learning and equity and talent are part of the learning game, but we're also looking at our financial support systems and how we can reallocate resources toward the work of learning and equity and talent. And then we're looking at this concept of working together. But what I didn't mention is that the Institute for Systems Innovation and Improvement has as its most ambitious goal, and I'm heartened to be here because I know you're doing this, we are going to teach ourselves how to improve. And I want to tell you, higher education never thought that dimming was about us. We don't produce widgets. Have you ever heard that? So if this worked for Toyota, there's no reason why it's going to work for our esteemed academy until the healthcare industry decided that improvement was probably the best way to get at the heart of patient care. So we are wildly embracing improvement science. Wildly, so wildly that my job, one of them, is to raise money. And these resources are meant to be passed along to the council and to other systems. You don't get any money if you don't train yourself in improvement science. That is how committed this little organization, this little NASH thing that you've never heard of, is committed to a methodology. And I always thought, I'm rounding third, as they say in Cincinnati, and heading home, I always thought that the reason we did not escalate our completion agenda across the country is because we did not have a shared methodology. We counted on everybody talking to everybody about what was working here that might work there, but we weren't using an evidence-based approach to do it. So the big bet of the power of systems, and I dare say the council and the collaborative, is that acquiring a methodology that is common to all of us, based on how successful it has been in healthcare, the social sector, not Toyota, but somebody we know, healthcare, might work for us as well. And that's why we're asking for the funding, and that's how we're going to divvy out the money. And we're going to raise $30 million by 2030, and we're already on our way to our first goal, which is $5 million by 2023. And we are investing in people who are aligned with a common methodology to assess outcomes. The drivers of systemness, I did not do these slides. I think convening power is really important. And we expect it, and you should expect it, of your leaders, your campus leaders, to understand what it means to draw people to the table. And I hope you will reflect on what your role is as a convener, no matter what your station is in the academy. I did not do these slides. I don't even know who the Avengers are, but I know what they stand for. Justice for all. It's only going to be an agenda we can drive together if we are very clear what the goal is. I have no business being here. There is no reason for Kentucky to question where it is. Honestly, I am icing on the cake. You already know what the agenda is, but we are developing, remember the beginning, a theory of systemness, convening power, and then collective impact, where we are all headed toward the same outcomes. Shared vision. Happily, President Obama did come to Buffalo to make this big announcement about the moonshot. Well, it probably wasn't the first time he did it, but we said it was. And then we used this slide, and then we have a video. And everybody's going crazy because it's in a basketball arena, and Obama's there talking about first in the world, and we are crying. You know, this is so right for us. So we still need that shared vision. This is not cheating. This is really borrowing, so that we learn from each other how to do it better. And then this notion of scale. I think the proper word here is sustainability. But by the time I was working on this PowerPoint, I ran out of steam. And of course, looking at it yesterday, I go, this is wrong. This is just wrong. And it's too late to change, because you would have gone crazy if I changed my slides. But it is about scale. And these systems in this country educate 75% of the undergraduate population. If we can't do it together, nobody can do it. So, I don't know, drivers? I don't know, I don't get that, but those are the five levers. Remember, I promised you a theory of systemness. And like Joe, who's quoting Carol Anderson from Emory, and then Aaron's quoting himself, surprise, surprise. I like this guy. I said take the picture off, it doesn't add anything, but he wrote once in the middle of the healthcare crisis, when we were passing legislation on universal healthcare. He wrote in an opening column, I used to think healthcare was our nation's biggest challenge, but I've changed my mind. It's really education. And you know this, and that's what was in these two quotations. Everything gets better with education. No matter what the question is, the answer is education. Your children are healthier, they're safer, you have a better lifestyle, you vote more, you're more civically engaged. I mean, it is universally understood, but not universally accepted, that education, educating more people and educating them better, is simply the best bet any society can make. And you're doing it. Congratulations. Hello. It's coming. Now it works.
Is it working?
Yeah.
Yes. So thank you so much, Dr. Zimpher. And we are out of time, but I'm making an executive decision because there were so many wonderful and big ideas in this presentation. Let's take two questions from the audience, and then we'll make a quick transition to the breakout sessions upstairs. It's a repeat from this morning, so you can choose a new session. And then immediately after that is a networking reception on the second floor with some desserts and the Bellarmine Student Jazz Band. So.
Advice would be welcome. You don't have to ask a question. Maybe I left something so really important out.
Questions or comments? Anybody have? Or they might just been overwhelmed by everything.
You need to, oh, thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Oh.
It's coming. You are.
How are you doing? My name is Aaliyah Cannon. I'm the SGA president at Northern Kentucky University. So I was excited to see your
you.
Slides.
Yeah.
So my question is, do you have any advice for the next generation of higher education workers on just going into the field and trying to help our students be successful?
Well, the question is, can we encourage others to go into this field to be the next Aaron Thompson, you know, to be the next Joe, Lily, Melissa? I mean, I could go on and on. I think the best key is your engagement right now. This is why around my office, which I have been rendered so incapable without my team, but if I had my choice, it's getting students in that office talking to us about their lived experience and framing what I would be saying as a convener, and that's the best experience. And I can tell you, I have tracked, chased, followed these student leaders from baccalaureate and two-year institutions to their careers now, and they do not stray. You see the power. You see the power, and you are groomed to do this. I don't know if you can turn from it. I don't know, but what you're stuck there, and we will be the better off for it. So keep doing what you're doing. I'm really proud that you're here today. Thank you. Hello.
Hello, good afternoon, and thank you so much for a great presentation. I'm Keturah Nix, Assistant Professor of English at Kentucky State University and also Acting Chair of the Division of Literature, Languages, and Philosophy. And my question is when coming into a leadership role, how do you strategize prioritization? Because there are a lot of different, tasks that are on you, a lot of people who have their own things that they think should be priority. How do you do that as a leader and also kind of hit those main points that you want to hit in your leadership?
You know how you use a person in the audience as your point person? If she was still alive and awake, I would be okay, we're okay here. I think it's a great question because that's why vision is so important. I will tell you, I served for 30 years at Ohio State. I watched, I don't know, 6 or 7 presidents come and go. And I was in such a state that they would always let me read the draft of the State of the University address. And I always wondered, what's hollow about this? I mean, it's creative, it's interesting, it's 20 pages, I'm sure you'll be great. But you know what? It never stuck to a theme. I mean, I think you can do no better than using the constituency and your convening power here or here to get a few people together who can help frame the agenda. Your life is easy. After that, I mean, I've been inaugurated, well, they didn't bother in New York, but I've been inaugurated a couple of times. And I waited a whole year, if they insisted on this, because I wanted my speech to be the result of all that convening. I wasn't up all night reading this speech. I'm just telling the truth. This is what we did for 12 months. We did this. And you know it, and you know it, and you know it, and you might not like it, but you got to say what you didn't like. And that matters in the world of the academy. So I just think you can't lead without that explicit statement of value and vision, and it will last you the lifetime of your leadership role. I absolutely guarantee you. And I don't know how to think of any other way to progress without having that shared vision, and I'm so glad this is my last remark because you all are so smart and you've got work to do. And Melissa and Aaron and Joe and Lily, thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Zimpher. Thank you all, and like I said, let's try to make a rapid transition and try to aim for breakout sessions starting at 2:15.